process. So you don't mind your own thought? So you need to summarize, and authorize good friends, delegates, and students. I'm very fortunate to be here. There's a man of us from your principal, a very good friend of mine. And I accepted this invitation at his request. Well, before I can speak, I must say congratulations to principal and the team of the college for taking this particular wonderful theme and the program for the national seminar. And it's very appropriate the chosen. And already the theme was been introduced to you by the principal himself and also the compare very appropriately. I have very limited job to say this seminar is open. And share a little bit of my thoughts with respect to rule of law. I am not here to give you any sermon. I am a very debatable topic when you are putting judicial activism in conjunction with rule of law. Rule of law is such a topic of its own significance. Judicial activism is also at the topic of its own significance. But putting these two together will be something very interesting, I hope. Most of you people will enjoy in the rest of the sessions when the proceedings will go on. To my mind, well, I always believe not in giving lectures and speeches. I believe in loud thinking. I believe in introspecting myself. Of course, on the basis of the little knowledge that I have been reading and gathering all these years, well, as already said, rule of law, by what Cassius said, what Lord Fuller has said, by your principal, I can't tell anything better than them, but still, there are Western ideas as much as the rule of law is a Western philosophy, most important philosophy in the governance of a nation. Now, I look to rule of law. When you are looking to law, the question comes whether the law is appropriate, just or unjust. It has been said it's not for the purpose of the judges to look into the just or unjust of the law for a long time. What is this dissection of just and unjust within the framework of the law? If you question this, you will look into the aspect within the law framework, there is something still interior, intricate. What is that something intricate? The intricacy lies in the backers of the law. The intricacy lies in the people who apply the law. The intricacy lies in the people who adjudicate and enforce the law. Well, as a common man, when he said, it is the law, does it mean that I have to shut my mouth and honor it? That is the question. And if it is a question, then maybe a parliament which enjoys 3/4 majority will make anything. Like it has been said in British parliament, parliament is so powerful, then it can back everything under the sun, except man, woman, and woman, and man. Well, are we in that particular age and stage to accept the law, as it is being described by the parliament, to be accepted in its own holistic regime? Yes, there was a day when king was the supreme head. Whatever that comes out from the mouth of the king is the finality of the law and the decision. But then came the principle, be of power high and mighty you are, still there is something above you. What is that? That is law. In other words, law being supreme, the might of law, made this particular king who has been ruling all these years, centuries probably, to a secondary place. What came out is the law. When that particular law which has been said to overrule the king and monarchy, what was that? Is it the law simple dictum? Well, friends, the best answer you can get only from Indian or Oriental discourses. You cannot get from the Western discourses. Because for us, when we look into these particular questions of law, we quickly get into from Niti, Nyay to Dharma. And Dharma is such a enduring and absorbing concept. It gives everything in a plate and explains what is a Dharma for Raja and called Raj Dharma. It is to be different from the Dharma which is meant for the Praja. All these particular articulations and answers will take you to one particular point. What is the particular inner morality what Tom Fuller has got with respect to law? Rule of law. What is the rule again of the law? You understand law, but what is the rule that guides the law? A sound proposition, a sound generalization, which the people are going to adhere and obey. If the rule of law, in other words, the dictates of the rule of law, well, if you look to the Judicial concept or the Fuller's concept, again I will reiterate those words. Fuller has said, by generality, the generality should be honored. It should not be focused to any particular group or segment. It should be applicable holistic. And it should be publicity. The word publicity is now being very differently used. It is being called transparent. Any rule or any law should be transparent. And it should be clear, clarity of law. And it should be constant. It should be feasible. It should have constancy. It's not that it's changing quite often. And it should be prospective. In other words, we're not looking to the behind, the fishermuts, telling you to the convergence. Well, what are these particular attributes? Lie there? If the lie is not general in nature, can you call it a law? The lie is not transparent, can you call it a law? If the lie is not clear, you don't understand it, can you call it a law? That is the reason the principles of natural justice intervene somewhere. Beyond principle of natural justice, the first and most thing Fuller has called them, the inner morality, I call them, the conscience of law. Law has to have its own brain and its own mind. Law is a living dynamic entity. Law is a living dynamic entity. And the life behind the law, like these confines of rule. That is rule of law. Now the question comes, when you are looking to the inner morality or the inner confines of the law, if they are not there or some of the attributes are missing, shall you call them a bad law? There are jurists who opine, how can it be bad law? It is no law at all. Because the essential elements are not there. If the essential elements are missing, then it misses the very characteristic of a law. So that is it. And this particular conscience dictates that law has to be law as such. There's nothing like good law and bad law. Either it's a law or no law. And this particular dictum comes from conscience. And slowly Fuller drifted from this particular generality of the conscience element to the Karmayogi philosophy. What is the Karmayogi philosophy? The law lies in the procedure or the law lies in the substance. Whether the goal of the law is important or whether the methods by which the law has to be implemented that is important. This actually has been debated for a long, long time. You know pretty well due process of law in America and procedure established by law in India. And Article 14 and Article 21 becomes handy. And Indian constitutional matters have made a wonderful constitution where they have really looked into this rule of law. And their conscience was very clear to make the law. So whenever you are making a law, in whatever the position you may be, or you are the beneficiary of the law, whether you are being the governing person who is governing the law or you are the governed by the law, in both situations, your conscience about what is law cannot be lost. This inner conscience is called dharma. If you go to Chanakya, he says the word dharmi tatparata. This particular phrase, dharmi tatparata, what does it mean? This is a concept that channels each and every individual right from the birth to death and beyond. The whole purpose of human life is for a dignified position of his own to ultimately attain the maximum of what he is worth to. How are you going to achieve this thing? It is possible only when you are able to understand your dharma within inside you and look to the opportunities of the applications that are being done to the law. In constitutional preamble, we have said opportunity in the case of equality. It should be provided to all. Well, it's an equal opportunity only. Because there is again a rule of law and a dharma. What is the dharma? Dharma unto an individual is a dignity factor. A factor I cannot be degraded in the society. I need to have my respectful position for what I am worth to. I must live a completeness or wholeness of the human life. And if at all I have to live a completeness or wholeness of a human life, how do I live? Well, here I ate my own business. Whether you are going to live in a society of competition, strife and struggle all the time? Are we not going to look into ourselves within? Yes, when you are trying to love, to look or dissect the law, the DNA of law, that is rule of law. So also you need to look into your own DNA. Whether whether you are capable of sitting in a particular position, authority, power, whether you have the inner potential to attain that. Well, until and unless scientifically, technically, logically, I identify what is my capacity, I am under strife of competition. My diver house is having one freeze to car and three jet lights, tickets. Why do I not have? How do you establish this commonness? Well, the opportunities are open. Why I am not able to reach them? They are just ego. My friend is able to swim the head of the river. I feel scared even to jump into the water. My friend goes away to the other side. I remain here. Shall I have to push him? Because I want to give him the equal opportunity. Or shall I have to say, no, you have to. I have to teach him learning. That's learning. These are some of the questions which the society needs to answer in the role of law. This is the predicament a judge suffers. What potential, what capacity, what rule of law, or what concepts, what inner potential or inner concepts? If I am not competing, but I am competing with myself, my inner concepts, if I am developing myself, I know how to grow myself to the maximum wealth. And I have nothing, never to look back, I have never to look this side or that side, I have nothing to compare. If my friend is something great, I have every reason to say, wonderful, you are the great. But there's no reason to cry, I am not so great. Look to the inner conscience. If the moment I say, I should be like my friend, then I start tearing myself. I'm ignoring my own inner conscience, I'm only looking at the world. That is how, when you're looking to the law, from a superficial touchstone, there's a difficulty. Well, so much so with the rule of law and inner conscience of rule of law, now coming to the judicial application of it. Well, judge, before going to the judge application, I must quote what the present Chief Justice of India, T.S. Thakur, on his very day of work, the moment he entered the office, he said, so long as rule of law is there and a strong and independent judiciary is functioning, no one should feel threatened. We are capable to protect rights of all citizens, cutting across caste, creed and religion. These are the words of Justice Thakur. Well, taking this particular aspect ahead, yes, we started debating on activism or activist judge only in 1980s. Before that, the judiciary in India was not labeled as any activists. They are just judiciary. They are apart. Anytime a judge is in a fight, there is nothing in the outcome whether party A wins or party B wins. Well, very well. In a football field, you know the umpire, how he runs along the player. So also judge runs along with the two advocates, two counsels. There is nothing to gain either this way or that way. You have to only say, yes, here you are foul, here you are right, here is your goal, or here is your no goal. And even if the particular party wins, there is nothing to rejoice or nothing to lose. That is how the judges have been functioning. And also in the activist time of the judges function the same way only. Because the litigations were at the time not won by what is called litigation by the government and government. Most of the litigations earlier was something different. The litigations came out by the persons who are in the power of governments against the people who are governed. Justice Krishna and the later judges Bhagwati of that particular era, 1980. The few wonderful judgments that have come up, which the whole society and the nation started saying is activist judgment. Well, looking to the old names of the judges, judges only delivery judgments. They have nothing to, again I reiterate, nothing to gain or nothing to lose in the outcome. But they can't contribute their own philosophy. How the wonderful apostle or philosopher, religious expert, a judge may be, that is for his own personal purpose. When he is sitting on the bench, he is a judge in empire, and his thesis before him is the law and the law and the rule of law in the consciousness of India. The rule of law in the consciousness of India. And looking to those particular philosophy reiterated in the consciousness, that is the rule of the conscience. The conscience of all Indian laws lies in the constitution. The judges have started applying. When they started identifying here is a problem, that problem ought to have attempted or attempted in the manner prescribed in the fundamental rights party of the constitution or by the preambular dictates of the constitution, they gave certain judgments. Then we call them activist judges. Who called? It is those particular people who felt the burden of governance has become heavier due to this type of judgments. But otherwise, I feel they are neither activism, nor they are, you can say, restraint. They are judgments, pure and simple. But when there is a gap in the law, when the government is sleeping, the parliament is not waking up, probably when the higher concerns like human rights and the constitution imposes a separate higher order of rule, like Justice Verma in Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan, he almost legislated the law what it should be for the nation, but however quickly added a rider, this will be the law until parliament enacts its own law. There probably some of the streaks of activism is there. But whenever there is any act of creativism, creativity, every judgment is a creative. Because every litigation is a creative art of counsels and the litigants. So whenever there is a creative art of writing a judgment, it can be definitely said an activist judgment. But in my mind, judges ought to apply the consent of the constitution, constitutional document in which is the consent, which is the consent of law, that is the rule of law. And this is a wonderful convergence of rule of law, and if you say it's a judicial activism, our judge's role in dispensing or understanding what is the government, that's okay. So this is how I summarize, and this is what I feel, and Dicey has made things very, very, very simple for understanding rule of law. When he was speaking with respect to equality, that equal protection and equal equality of law in the Indian constitution. I am not here to discuss on that. I am sure you will look to this particular, in this particular seminar, you will explore other various subjects and definitely come out with enlightening analysis when Fuller called rule of law can be a part of dignity. And when he called inner morality, when he could not substantiate that it is, and he had to face the wrath of Professor Hart. And very interesting discourse are there with respect to rule of law. But rule of law is a game of law.
nonsense. So I even conclude by saying and revoking from this particular Western concept of rule of law to Chanakya's concept of dharma tatparata. This dharma tatparata involves in each one of us to be ready and ever present and ever prepared to accept the dharma. When you speak of dharma, the inner conscience, or you need to call for your conscience, nothing can be greater than your own conscience. And if your own conscience is with respect to dharma, the greater dharma, still the greater dharma, so on, the philosophical aspect of understanding that the grand norm of it. And if you understand the grand norm of dharma, again you can be powerful. I think very much pregnant and complete holds of Indian concept of dharma. Maybe some of you people will take this responsibility of looking dharma and rule of law in a much more cohesive manner. And that will be some of the